Scholar at the Emerging Markets Forum in Washington, D.C., and a Senior Fellow at the Results for Development Institute, and a Senior Research Fellow at the International Initiative for Impact Evaluation. So lots of jobs. The floor is yours.
Right. Thank you very much. I understand I have to talk close to the microphone. If I don't, please wave at me and I'll try to do better. So I will talk to you briefly about a regional approach to address climate change in Central Asia. Better to use this one? Okay, whatever works. Now, you may want to may wonder what Greater Central Asia is refers to, and it's actually seven countries. You see the list on the right and the picture on the right, Afghanistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Mongolia, Pakistan, PRC, China, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan. These countries have gotten together in a multilateral organization that's referred to as Central Asia Regional Economic Cooperation Program. And you see on the slide a link to where you find much more information. But let me just say that this organization has been in place for about almost 25 years. And it has invested, or rather under its umbrella, a lot of money has been invested in infrastructure, especially transport and energy, but also in trade and trade facilitation and transit facilitation, around 40 billion over the US dollars over the 20, 25 years. So far, this organization has not focused on climate change and action relating to climate change, but it did decide about 2 or 3 years ago that it was time to do so. And so the CAREC ministers, who get together once a year in a ministerial conference, decided to commission a scoping study on climate change in the region, basically to determine what are the problems that we face and what are some of the things we could do about the problems, not just country by country, but actually with a regional perspective and regional cooperation as the core objective. Now, this study, I was involved as the chief author and leader of that project, was finished and presented to the ministerial conference in 2022. And based on that, the decision was made to prepare a climate change vision statement document, which we prepared. And when I say we, it's actually this CAREC Secretariat, which is housed at Asian Development Bank. We prepared as a small team, prepared with my personal engagement, also a climate vision document for implementation 2024 to 2030. And I want to briefly summarize what these documents contain, entail, and then, of course, answer any questions you might have about it. From my perspective, this is significant because it means that there's now a focus not only on climate change, but actually what I believe is very important on the regional aspects and regional cooperation in Central Asia, Greater Central Asia. Now, it should stress this is, of course, a very heterogeneous set of countries, and in particular, China is a great outlier. And so much of what the report says isn't so much about China. It's a bit about the China border regions with Mongolia and with Central Asia, but it's more about what China could do to support climate action in Central Asia. So that's by way of background. Now, very briefly, the scoping study covered a broad range of issues, as you can see, and we categorized them to put a bit of structure around it into eight core issues. You see the ones in red, by the way, are issues where regional dimensions, regional cooperation challenges, opportunities are particularly important. So energy, water, agriculture, disasters, transport, cities, and health are kind of the core issues that we believe challenges and opportunities for action face the region. Then there are a number of cross-cutting issues. And incidentally, I should say, we looked at this from a national and regional perspective for each of these issues, and also looked at, but didn't really separate, because I believe all these issues have actually mitigation and adaptation aspects. We didn't carefully separate or categorize by mitigation or adaptation aspects. Cross-cutting issues, a number of them, I won't run through them, but including macro, private sector, ICT, digital. Important perhaps to mention advocacy and communication, because actually one really has to do a better job in terms of communicating the climate challenge and the potential for action. Then finally, a set of on the horizon issues, which are issues that, yes, are out there, maybe not yet urgent, but need to be watched, need to be watched for the region in particular. And here we have some energy issues such as energy storage or hydrogen development, artificial intelligence. 2 years ago, we thought, eh, that's kind of way out there. Of course, today just shows it's right at the center now of some of the concerns. So migration and a bunch of new concepts that the regional decision makers ought to be thinking about in this dimension. Now, the main messages that came out of this report is that climate change presents a major challenge for the CAREC countries and requires urgent and powerful response. But also it isn't just a challenge, actually also an opportunity, as the region can participate in the new climate economy as a driver for growth and prosperity in the long term. However, so far, not enough attention, some but not enough attention has been paid to these issues. Climate change has important regional impacts and require regional action. Again, so far, not enough attention actually among the countries in the region, including by CAREC itself, had been paid. National, regional action are complementary, so they don't conflict with each other. And in national policies and strategies, we actually need to make sure that regional dimensions are more adequately contained. The systemic nature of climate change requires not just one ministry in the government, but all of government, not just the government, but actually all of country, and not just one country, but actually all of region. Approach so far, the approach has been fragmented at best, and so more coordination, cooperation across these different levels is actually very important. The fifth conclusion is that national regional strategies and regional strategies, in particular the national NDCs, the national, what does it stand for, mental block. Anyway, these are the the mitigation plans and the adaptation plans need to set priorities. It isn't good enough to just have vague plans. You actually have to have specific priorities and sequencing, and they need to be effectively implemented, monitored, and adapted in line of experience. Now, with the common implementation issues in governments and other stakeholders in the region, we know that implementation is always a challenge, and so that will need watching carefully. Private sector plays a role. So far, private sector has been not sufficiently capacitated or involved. And finally, very critical, the domestic and external finance constraints are severe. Domestic, because you have constrained fiscal space in the countries. Again, China is a separate issue. And the financial sector development is relatively poor. Moreover, international finance, while available in principle, is actually highly fragmented and difficult to access. So all of these are areas that one should and can focus on as you develop climate action plans, both nationally and regionally. And so with that in mind, and by way of background, let me actually, in the interest of time, move straight on. A climate vision, goals, and principles document was developed, with the climate vision being, of course, very high level, a region of sustainable development, shared prosperity, and climate resilience, with three goals: to mitigate, adapt, and cooperate, and three principles: align across national strategies, deepen regional cooperation, very critically, expand corporate coordination with the development partners, these are the multilateral development banks and so on, integrate private sector and civil society into your action plans, and build an open regional platform. Now, in addition to those general principles, the vision statement also reiterates some of the and focuses on some of the major issues that are already summarized. So it does provide also some guidance in each of the areas of where attention needs to be focused. And then at the end, it reflects decisions made by CAREC ministers, and I'll briefly summarize those, and that's the last slide here. Ministers endorsed the vision document, and they also decided that CAREC in future will in fact make climate change one of its major pillars of work, which previously, as I noted, had not been the case. So CAREC now will focus unequivocally on the climate change issue. A climate change steering group, a CAREC climate change steering group, will be set up, is in the process of being set up, supported by an expert group that will provide technical input and guidance. There will be developed by the steering group a three-year CAREC climate action plan that prioritizes and phases action, very important, prioritize and phase actions, And we also will have the development, and it should start up fairly soon, a project preparation fund that actually allows the preparation of specific climate-oriented investment projects, because one of the issues that one faces is that bankable and financeable projects in this area tend to be very scarce. So you actually need specific resources and dedicated focus on project preparation. In order to make sure there's good coordination with the international finance community, CAREC will organize development partners forums, which will serve the purpose of motivating, coordinating, and to making sure that the international financial organizations, bilateral, by the way, and also multilateral, are being integrated into the program. And finally, as I mentioned earlier, I think it's important that there be a communication outreach plan, because the people at large, as we well know, are not yet really on board with this particular agenda. Now, in case you're interested, this is just a bit more information on the Project Preparation Fund, but I won't go into it. In case you're interested in references for the documents I mentioned. So the scoping study is the first bullet. Vision document is the second bullet. The third bullet is a personal advertisement, because we actually put out a blog on the Brookings website that basically summarizes what I just said with a bit more detail. And if you want to get the short version of these documents, I recommend you take a quick look at this particular blog. Thank you very much, Robert. I hope I didn't go on for too long.
Great. Thank you very much. So now we'll turn to Kate Waters, who's the founder and executive director of Crude Accountability, co-founder. And she will talk to us about environmental defenders in Central Asia.
Great, thank you so much. And thank you to Sebastian and everybody here for organizing this incredible day of really interesting discussion and conversation. I wanna talk today about environmental defenders in Central Asia, and specifically about civil society. And I'm not going to provide you with a lot of statistics and a lot of numbers, but I want to tell some stories about how civil society activists in the region are coping with some of the key environmental concerns that they're facing. And listening to the conversation over the course of the day, one of the things that strikes me is that the case studies that I want to share with you today are similar to a lot of the stories that we've heard in terms of being regional, involving more than one organization, and being related to the energy sector are the ones that I'm going to focus on today. I want to pull back for just a moment and talk a little bit more broadly about civil society in Central Asia, which is very endangered right now. There's a lot of threats to civil society in all five countries of Central Asia, and legislative and sort of administrative pressure being put on civil society organizations really following a template that comes really straight out of Russia, right out of the Russian Federation, and how the authorities there have been treating civil society. Whether that's foreign agent lists, crackdowns on civil society more generally, increased efforts to imply that civil society organizations are connected somehow to Western interests and don't really have anything to do with local or indigenous concerns, have made it harder and harder for NGOs and other civil society organizations to operate throughout Central Asia. We see this in all the countries in the region. I'll just reiterate, with the threat of new limiting legislation against civil society in Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan, brutal crackdowns on civil society in Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, and ongoing repression in Turkmenistan, which has really been a black hole since 2003, so for over 20 years. And this is taking place in a context of increasing authoritarianism and corruption. We heard about corruption a little bit earlier today, but just to provide some context, out of 180 countries, 180 being the worst number, that have been measured for corruption, Turkmenistan is at 170, Tajikistan 162, Uzbekistan 121, Kazakhstan 93, Kyrgyzstan 141. And in terms of freedom, I won't go through all of the numbers, but on a scale of 100, Turkmenistan is 2. the best quote unquote country with regard to freedom in Central Asia is Kyrgyzstan with a number of 27, and all countries in Central Asia have been identified by Freedom House as consolidated authoritarian regimes. So I just want to lay this groundwork to describe the circumstances in which the environmental defenders that I'm going to talk about have been working in. As I said, I want to highlight three cases, not only to focus on the threats to environmental defenders, which are very real and very concerning, but also where defenders have been working together and actually able to make a difference in the region. And we heard earlier about hydropower, and I want to focus the first part of my remarks on that as a very critical energy source. And also, you know, we've heard a lot about the melting of the glaciers and the increase of problems with lack of water and access to water in Central Asia. And I want to focus on the project of the Rogun Dam in Tajikistan, which has been an ongoing problem for many, many years. It's a massive hydropower dam on the Vakhsh River in the Pamir Mountains. It's about 60 kilometers from the capital, Dushanbe. And the project has been on and off over years. I won't go into all of the details, but again, has been attracting financing from international financial institutions, including the World Bank. And it's been under scrutiny from environmental and human rights defenders inside Tajikistan, but also from the international community for the climate impacts associated with this massive dam, environmental threats, including to a World Heritage Site, and human rights concerns, including the forced relocation of thousands of local people. Environmental defenders in Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan are concerned about the impacts of the dam and have succeeded in raising awareness about their concerns, not only inside Central Asia, but also internationally. Last week, on the day of the International Action for Rivers, advocates from the region joined together with international coalitions, including Rivers Without Boundaries and the Coalition for Rights and Development, and they appealed to the World Bank and 15 other financiers to refrain from further financing the Rogun Dam project. And especially given the current and repressive environment that these NGOs are working with and these local activists are working in, the ability of regionally based environmental defenders to engage in this international conversation and international activism with climate defenders from around the world, I think just is an interesting example of what is possible even in the current environment that we're seeing in the region. It's quite remarkable. Another example also in the energy sector has to do with nuclear power. And for this story, I'm turning to Kazakhstan, which has a long history of opposing nuclear power that goes back even to the Soviet period. Some of you may remember the Semipalatinsk, the Novaya Semipalatinsk movement. And in the early 2000s, environmental defenders in Kazakhstan won a major, major victory when they defeated a proposal by their government to import nuclear waste from Europe into the country and have it buried there. Local environmental defenders at that time, who were led by Kaisha Tahanova, who won the 2005 Goldman Environmental Prize for her efforts, were victorious through a creative campaign, which included creating a groundswell of popular support for their campaign by literally traveling around the country and talking to people, local community members, about what it would mean to have nuclear waste buried in their country and in their communities. Because of their credentials, they were scientists, not only activists, who had done research on Semipalatinsk during and after the Soviet period. They were able to explain this issue in local language, in language that made sense to ordinary people, and they defeated this effort. And in something, I just need to share this part of it, something that sounds really archaic now, but at the time was like groundbreaking activist technology. They did fax attacks on the Ministry of Energy. If anybody here can even remember what a fax machine is, they would send hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of faxes to the ministry, which kind of like blew up the communications capacity of the ministries to do anything. And literally they were able to win this campaign. So this was great, right? They stopped the import of nuclear waste into their country. Unfortunately, right now, Kazakhstan is again under pressure with regard to nuclear and in the environmental hazards. And you may have read in the press even that there's consideration of opening a new nuclear power plant on the banks of Lake Balkhash, which was mentioned earlier as one of the threatened bodies of water in Central Asia. President Tokayev said that he would hold a public referendum on the issue, which is already progress, right? And environmental defenders, many of them who were part of this team that was working, you know, 20 years ago, but also with new, you know, kind of younger activists as well, are going around the country right now talking to people about what it would mean to build a nuclear power plant, which is being touted as clean energy, no greenhouse gases. You know, we were hearing the same kinds of arguments in the United States about the benefits of nuclear. But it's a real engagement with the community about what this means, right? What this public policy impact would be for ordinary citizens. And civil society activists are engaged in this in Kazakhstan. So you heard the name of our organization, Recruit Accountability. So I'd be remiss without telling a story about oil and gas. And I don't think I need to explain that civil society organizations, environmental defenders, climate groups working on fossil fuel development in Central Asia have been under massive repression for years and years, including now. It's one of the riskiest areas to work, not only because of, you know, the fact that they're up against major oil and gas companies, but also because this is a huge part of the economy of Kazakhstan, right? Petroleum products make up the largest export from Kazakhstan. And, you know, major Western oil companies like Chevron and others are huge contributors to the economy, as well as the Chinese CNPC. So there's risk there. And just as an example of this, 2 weeks ago, an environmental conference was held in Atarau by local environmental defenders on the impacts of oil and gas, because there's expansion going on at the Tengiz field. And they wanted to involve international experts and civil society activists who had been engaged in monitoring oil and gas for years, and invited some of us, I'm going to say, to participate on Zoom. And so the authorities just turned the electricity off in the building. So there was no internet, there was no electricity, there was no power, there was no way to engage with any of the international participants who were supposed to be part of the project. Not physically threatening or dangerous to anybody in the room, but clearly an irritant. Groups that have been monitoring Chinese investments in the oil and gas sector have been threatened and worry about accusations of espionage. There's even there is one case of a very prominent scholar who was imprisoned on espionage charges for monitoring the impacts of Chinese investments in the oil and gas sector. But there have been successes, and I want to end my remarks with telling this story of success. So in January of this year, the government of Kazakhstan announced that it would stop production at an oil field called the Kokshida oil field, which is operated by Chinese, South Korean, and Kazakhstani operators, that sits on top of one of the largest freshwater aquifers in Kazakhstan. It has the capacity to provide drinking water to millions and millions of people. It's a protected area, but for some reason, they were able to build a massive field there. And the Department of Ecology of Aktube region, which is where the field is, said that all 300 wells, there are 300 wells there, and all the associated equipment with that field must be removed by 2030. The removal process is being conducted in phases to avoid disturbing the aquifer, which is very fragile, that's underneath it, but it's an ongoing process. And this decision was the result of years of work by local population, environmental organizations, and also South Korean organizations and international organizations, including my own, who worked together with scholars, journalists, specialists to protest the extraction at Kokshida and raise awareness around how dangerous this was to one of the very few remaining clean sources of drinking water in Western Kazakhstan. So we need, of course, to continue to monitor this to make sure that it is in fact shut down and that the water aquifer is protected. But I share these stories to remind us that we, even when it's difficult, even when the situation is repressive, when there is an interest in sort of regional cooperation and making that link, right? Why? How does climate impact us? It impacts our drinking water, it impacts our soil, and it impacts the health of our children. That's when people get involved. And we heard that about the CAREC efforts of really trying to make this understandable to local populations and to local individuals. So I'll stop with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kate. That was great. So now we'll turn to our online presenters. And we'll start with Suzy Blondin from the University of Neuchâtel, talking about climate mobility in Central Asia.
Hello, everyone, and thank you very much first to the organizers. I'm happy to be part of this panel today. My name is Suzy Blondin. I'm a geographer based in Switzerland, and I have been working on Tajikistan's Pamirs for some years now, where I have conducted fieldwork for my PhD. So my presentation today is called Climate Mobilities in Central Asia, an Understudied Issue. And I will try to give some insight into my research in Tajikistan while also looking at the bigger regional picture to give some broader elements on the topic of climate mobilities concerning the whole region. So I suggest to start here with the state of the art, which I have published in 2019 in the Central Asian Survey, where I have attempted to review studies on the topic of environmental migrations in Central Asia, and in which I have put forward the dramatic lack of studies on the topic. So according to this review, it appeared that Central Asia was repeatedly presented as a hotspot of climate change in the literature, given the region's aridity, the presence of high mountain areas and regional water management issues, among others. But the human consequences of climate change in the region constituted a research gap, both for regional studies and for social sciences. So in the article, I have also put forward some potential research directions that could help address the issue and embrace the specificities of the region in terms of climate change and mobility. For instance, given the important part of the region's population living in rural areas and dependent on local agriculture, the threats posed by floods or droughts on some lands can have severe socioeconomic consequences, including, for instance, food insecurity or unemployment. And these types of climate hazards can also have negative effects on the residents' health. For instance, vector-borne diseases can proliferate in case of floods. Heat waves may cause cardiovascular diseases and droughts, respiratory problems, or chronic forms of malnutrition. In addition, both access to food resources and to healthcare facilities are challenging in some rural or mountainous areas of Central Asia and can become arduous or even impossible in case of floods, landslides, or avalanches, for instance. So following this publication, I have reorientated my research directions towards the issue of environmental mobilities in Tajikistan. The main idea behind my research was to investigate lifestyles and mobilities of Tajikistan Pamir Mountains residents with a case study of the Bartang Valley, which is considered particularly remote physically and poor in socioeconomic terms. So my work is an ethnography relying on 9 months of fieldwork, during which I have paid particular attention to people's mobilities to and from their village, to the cities or between villages, and also to the ways they considered or reflected upon their mobilities within the region, country, or even abroad. And by using qualitative methods and sharing the residents' everyday lives, I have attempted to go beyond deterministic bias, which associate climate and migration in simplistic terms, and to explore different sociocultural or economic elements influencing the relationship between climate and migration. So progressively, I have reframed my research questions towards mobilities rather than migration. More specifically, I have analyzed everyday, frequent, or small-scale mobilities as they seemed to be impacted by environmental hazards. Although they appear to be understudied both in the topical and in the theoretical literature. So the idea was to understand how local roads or cars, for instance, were impacted by floods, avalanches, or rock slides, and how the occurrence of such hazards could influence the ways the barangays move and also the consequences of mobility difficulties or immobilities. So, of course, hazards are not the only element impacting such mobilities. There is also a crucial lack of available cars and of appropriate road maintenance in the region, and not to mention the absence of public transport. However, my case study on the Orttung Valley showed that residents frequently become involuntarily immobile and lack transport options, and that environmental hazards aggravate this issue. Such mobility issues threaten food security, access to different resources and services, or also to socioeconomic opportunities, because they further isolate the valley. And the case study also gave me the opportunity to elaborate theoretical reflections on the crucial importance of examining everyday mobilities, roads, or infrastructure when we seek to analyze the environment-mobility nexus. Another important part of my work consisted in the exploration of people-place relationships, or in the ways the barangays perceive and reflect upon their place of residence, and how this may influence their decision to stay, to live, and to practice mobilities. So to do so, I have applied a human geography perspective to my work and mobilized the concept of place attachment. In Orttung, many residents explained to me that despite their livelihoods being dependent on out-migration to Dushanbe or Russia mostly, they perceived migration only as a life stage, as a means and not as an end. Many residents, and among them past migrants or aspiring migrants, also viewed migration as something they had to endure for the sake of their family, although it was not their personal aspiration or choice. In Orttung, it is very common to use the expression Watan Shirin, home sweet home, to illustrate the attachment to the valley, the village, or the house. So many of my interviewees emphasized their attachment to a valley perceived as preserved or unspoiled from the turmoil and the pollution of the city, or from tensions in the border areas with Afghanistan, for instance. And maybe most importantly, attachment to a valley which is home to the Orttung community and its specificities in terms of language, lifestyle, or culture. And the valley is also perceived by many as a refuge, panogo, where to stay or to return to feel safe in case of conflicts nearby. So many of my interlocutors told me, for instance, the story of the return or of forcibly displaced residents in the 50s to illustrate the determination of the Orttungis to stay in their valley. So all these elements were brought forward as influencing the aspiration to stay put as an individual or as a family, as a community, despite ongoing difficulties, be they socioeconomic or, of course, climate related. So before concluding, I would like to say that since 2019, since the publication of the State of the Art that I have mentioned, I have not updated my literature review as I have been working on other topics, so I may ignore some papers or projects working currently on environmental mobilities in the region, but I would like to highlight here some recent papers and initiatives that have addressed the issue and participated in filling the research gap. For instance, the Kawamnet project, which is based in Germany, but involves many Central Asian scholars and practitioners, develops an international and interdisciplinary network to discuss and understand the role of climate change and governance in water conflicts and human migration. So the project leaders have already organized two workshops and have different research and papers on the meeting. And 2023 Central Asian Survey article by Vakulchuk and colleagues called "A Void in Central Asia Research Climate Change" offers a systematic literature review and brings forward climate change and its consequences as important research gaps for the region. And this paper also offers recommendations such as prioritizing funding of social science research on climate change in Central Asia, expanding research on climate impacts in Central Asia, or also encouraging area study scholars to turn their attention to climate change. So it seems that the topic is growing attention. So let's hope new research projects will shed light on this important topic and offer policy recommendations. And as a conclusion, I would like to again remind or stress that climate change is a pressing issue for Central Asian states. And the specificities being for Central Asia that climate change increases existing vulnerabilities in many parts of the region. So when we study climate change and its human dimension including mobilities, it is paramount to go beyond sensationalism and exceptionalism, but to understand that climate change and environmental hazards are already a reality for many people across Central Asia, and that climate change acts as a threat multiplier that should be taken seriously. For instance, when we talk about roads or other mobility infrastructure, environmental hazards already distort or destroy mountain roads and paths in the region. And in addition, frequent heat waves also distort asphalt and railways, for instance, and raise the issue of the vulnerability of the mobility infrastructure. And before finishing, I would like to emphasize the importance of a qualitative perspective on these topics, as they help uncover the complexity of people's perceptions and decision-making processes. And also the importance of exploring indigenous ways to frame and conceptualize both climate change and mobilities or immobility, and to try to avoid framing this question in Eurocentric or Western-centric ways. And this, of course, also stresses the need to highlight and promote the work of local scholars on these topics. And last but not least, I think it would be important to raise the question of the climate-related dimension of so-called labor migration from Central Asia. Not only as an economic problem, but as a multifaceted issue in which environmental change probably plays an increasingly central role. And I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Suzy. So we have about 20 minutes left before the break, and I'd like to open the floor now for questions from the audience. So if you have a question, please identify yourself and fire away.
Thank you, Alejandro Sanchez. I'm an analyst here in DC. Question for Darzhan. The last graph that you showed had the AIFC, the Stanley International Financial Center. I know that a couple of years ago they created the Green Financial Center within the AIFC. Do you have any update on how successful this agency has been? Also, in your research, have you touched on the issue of green bonds? No, Kazakhstan has made a big issue of issuing ESG green bonds. I think the Development Bank of Kazakhstan issues them. Have they been any successful towards Kazakhstan, the government's green policies? Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead and answer that question if you'd like to.
Yes, thank you so much for this question. Yes, so as you can, the financial center was actually launched after the Expo 2017, and they started as a platform that not only tries to implement green innovations, but also like to revisit the technology that is actually on place. They did a great research. They started to across the country, as a part of those organizations who are closely work with government, they do not take advantage of local organizations. So it's supposed to be a bridge between NGOs and activists and the centrum. I don't see that they are so active. They kind of has a plan. For example, they worked on a revision of and creation of new technologies that has to be used to provide a green economy. In this case, I would say that a green association takes huge efforts. So they are working with local, but also international experts. They have this communication. They have a solar festival that takes from 2019 to kind of collaborate and create this platform. If that's all what I have for you.
Thank you very much. I guess there's a question in the back there.
So Eric Rudenschold with the Caspian Policy Center. I've got a quick question, I hope, for each of you. Starting with Johannes, you speak about CAREC and its large role as a convener. And I wonder, in terms of international organizations and this overarching approach to looking at a developing a regional platform, is there any movement towards prioritization on what to do first and second and how you get governments in the region on board for dealing with that? And then Kate, you talk about, to a degree, a little bit about international funding to assist in developing some kind of policy that might support environmental defenders. Is there a mandate that international interlocutors can bring to bear that would empower the defenders, these CSO defenders in the region, and could they provide oversight on use of funds? Then let's see, Suzy, the question, you talk a lot about alpine communities. What about steppe communities? What about people at lower levels who don't have as much access to water as some of the folks in the high levels in Tajikistan do? Is there anything you can tell us about mobility and what people on the lower levels face? And then lastly, for Darzhan, if we look at the Nazarbayev era, there were lots of starts and stops, but the as you indicate, there are some positive trends taking place now with the Tokayev administration, but for a country that depends upon gas, oil, and coal for its economy, how does it make this green transition at this critical time? Thanks.
Thank you for those four questions. So we'll start with you, Johannes.
Thanks very much. It's the skepticism you, I think, imply, at least in your statement, is well taken. We know that regional organizations, with maybe the exception of the EU, and even that's debatable, have limited effectiveness in terms of actually implementing, as you say, prioritizing, then implementing effectively. Among the regional organizations that I've been monitoring over the last 20, 30 years in various capacities, I think CAREC is one of the more effective ones. And the reason why it's so is because it's clearly focused on the economic and now future climate agenda. Secondly, it's been actively supported and had in-depth engagement by the multilateral development institutions, by the way, including the IMF, also UNDP, World Bank, Asian Development Bank, EBRD, and the Islamic Development Bank, which not only provided financing, but also provided sort of the technical and analytical support that led to significant investments, but also changes, especially in the transport sector, with improvements in border crossings, facility improvement in the transport corridors, and in the energy sector, a revival actually of the power grid that had fallen apart after the Soviet Union collapse. So there has been impact, and I think it's demonstrable. There's also been a lot of limitations to how effective this has been relative to what in some sense should be happening in regional cooperation. For a long time, it couldn't focus on water issues because Uzbekistan blocked it. Just to give an example, now there's actually more of a focus on water and also linked to energy and agriculture. Looking ahead, yeah, I think we'll have to wait and see. And the development of this three-year action plan is going to hopefully convert the strategies vision into prioritized and sequenced action, as I pointed out. It's being supported by a fairly large technical assistance grant from Asian Development Bank. So there will be technical input that's absolutely critical, but ultimately, of course, it does depend on the political will, if you wish, of the countries, but also ultimately on whether or not the international organizations actually are willing to cooperate, collaborate, and provide effective access to their financing, which, for example, the case of the Green Climate Fund has been really a challenge for countries to get access with the ease that's required to actually move quickly. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that question. There are numerous international mechanisms and institutions that are designed to protect not only environmental defenders, but civil society defenders more broadly. We have special rapporteurs, we have UN mechanisms. The international financial institutions have social and environmental standards that need to be upheld, including protection of, you know, local community members who would speak out against a project. There's all sorts of mechanisms in place for that, none of them legally binding, I might add, but they do exist. The OSCE also has an entire division that is focused on, you know, the human dimension, as they call it, human rights, civil society. And the OECD has mechanisms through their national focal points for corporate behavior and corporate accountability and responsibility. And these are all mechanisms that civil society activists have access to and their partners in the West have access to. We also have international conventions like the Aarhus Convention that for those countries that are signatories to them, most of the Central Asian countries are, you know, the right to have access to information about environmentally relevant projects, the right to participate in that decision-making and access to justice if that's denied. So all of that is there and it is available. The issue is that in this region, there's really an absence of the rule of law in many, many instances. And the international partners who come in are frequently corporations, oftentimes are behaving as though the rule of law exists. And so if we just play by the rules and sort of do what we would do as business as usual, it's all going to work out okay in the end. And unfortunately, the most vulnerable are those defenders who are on the ground in the communities where the projects are taking place. And without access to independent media sources to relay those stories, who are also under tremendous threat right now, it ends up being a lot more complicated and a lot more difficult for defenders on the ground to actually access the resources and the mechanisms that are available for them.
Oh, thank you for the question. So yes, we can see kind of trends under Nazarbayev's presidency to attract mostly investments and also like show Astana as an attractive platform for different international actions, but I would say under the presidency of Tokayev, we kind of see focus and more attention to renewable energy. Of course, you are right, 70% of emissions in Kazakhstan come from coal generation. The issue of replacing coal generations with cleaner energy is on the agenda. And the energy system of Kazakhstan is completely degraded over the 30 years. So of course, there are huge problems, but we see kind of a positive attention However, as the speaker noted, this back and forth referendum that has to be taking place about atomic creation in Balkhash Sea, and this kind of not clear and open discussion among people, citizens, and those who live in this area is still under a big question. That's why we need more activists and those who can bring through the social media attention and kind of like a transparency of what is going in the policy. But I would say that, and this number that I mentioned, like a 5.92% of energy generation, which kind of looks very small, but for the country that hugely depends on extraction of oil, gas, and coal, it's a kind of clear step forward.
Suzy?
Yes, thank you. And so regarding the question of STEP communities in Tajikistan, so in my work, I have really focused on mountain communities. So I'm not a specialist of the lowlands, but what I can say is that clearly the populations in the lowlands are less affected by rapid onset disasters, although they can also be affected by floods, for instance. But I think what I can say is that we clearly need more studies on the effect of slower onset disasters, such as droughts, for instance, on migration and in relation with agricultural issues, as we have evidence from other parts of the world where, for instance, in case of droughts, when people are affected by droughts, if they have less income, less agricultural income, it means that sometimes they have less capacities to move or to send someone abroad, for instance. So yeah, I think we clearly need more studies on that.
We have a question up here.
I'm a Peter Humphrey, an intelligence analyst and a former diplomat. The presentations today are very much doom and gloom. And there's not always 100% losers. And then one of the intelligence agencies flipped this question on its head and said, let's look at all the countries in the world and see who the winners are. And when they did that, there was a big winner in Central Asia. And so to be good scientists, to be truly good analysts, doesn't some fraction of our effort have to be looking at the probable aspects of global warming that are going to benefit certain countries? For example, two growing seasons instead of one, or a fantastic potential for greenhouses, for example. And yet we have zero effort looking at that. Now, we need hybridization probably and some genetic engineering to make sure those crops can fill their potential in a warmer world. But none of that's going to happen unless we admit the good news.
All right. Who wants to take that question?
Yes. No, I think it's a good question. And a reminder that indeed there are places in Central Asia, among others, which will, as we have seen in terms of precipitation, for example, will benefit relative to their current lack of or lower level of precipitation. But that is the exception. It's not the rule. You're right that, of course, for Siberia and Central Asia more generally, Northern Central Asia, the rise in temperature in some ways is a benefit. But overall, if you put everything together, and I can give you the litany, which I won't, let me just say, ask you to look at our scoping study. The overall assessment is that climate change is a problem for Central Asian countries that they better address on an urgent basis. So yes, there are opportunities. And exactly as you say, there are solutions to the climate change challenge and more generally to the development challenge that involves innovation, that involves, coming now ahead, AI. And there's, in fact, exactly as you say, there is potentially a lot of good news. And so we really have to balance, and that's why I appreciate your question. We have to balance the threat that climate change represents with the good news that if we take appropriate action, then we can actually collectively benefit. And I think the problem that we currently have is that, yes, there is so much crying of wolf that people just turn off and don't want to deal with that at all. So we really have to find ways to more, and this is where communication and what have you comes in very importantly, where we have to show that it is a threat, a challenge, but it's also a real serious opportunity. I hope that goes some ways to answer.
We have another question. Did anyone else want to answer that question? Okay, we have one more question.
Yes, hi, Mitchell Pullman. This is almost as much a comment as a question, but I was in Uzbekistan last summer in July. I don't really recommend it that time of year, but that's kind of related. There's a phenomena there that Uzbekistan, while it's still maybe at the low end of the economic ladder, is in fact rising economically. And with a rising economy comes rising prosperity and rising expectations, with the result people that more and more people were buying air conditioners, lots of them, and it was straining the electrical grid, which is not designed to handle that. And this actually is a political issue, in fact. Power outages are resulting. I spoke to somebody at the U.S. Embassy. I'm no engineer, but he was explaining what an incredibly complicated situation it is, and USAID is working on it. But this, of course, also means, you know, the burning of more carbons. I haven't really heard anything about how we can simultaneously improve the economies in this part of the world where so many people are living on the margins while at the same time keeping things green. I mean, obviously there is some solar power and all that, but to the extent that would really be able to power thousands of air conditioners, I don't know. You know, the traditional form of keeping cool seems to be eating lots of melons, but nobody is going to do that anymore. So,
All right. Does anybody want to address that question? The question is, rising prosperity leading to more air conditioners, which has a negative impact on the grid and the environment.
Sure, cars.
Cars, everything.
All the accoutrements of Western life.
Well, this is where green cities, I mean, just to address your particular question of air conditioning, mostly in the growing cities, is green cities is a challenge. Again, it is an opportunity because by changing building regulations, for example, building more green and efficient, energy efficient housing and office buildings and what have you, you can actually go a long way to reduce the energy requirement per building. And so part of it is going to be, and there's a medium to long-term solution to the short-term problem, which Kazakhstan, as you mentioned, and others face right now. The long-term solution is to make your cities more energy and more generally much more efficient. So that is the challenge, but it's also going back to the opportunity because, you know, if you have an energy system that over time will turn more green, is better interconnected, actually benefits from, and I at some point, we could come back to the Rogun example, benefits from the very green hydropower that the Central Asia region has, but not every country in Central Asia has, by actually interconnecting and investing properly in green energy, which CAREC, among others, is trying to do and support. Then, you know, some of these tensions, very natural tensions that arise between, on the one hand, winners and losers, and between trying to contain a threat and maintain growth can be resolved, but it will take time, it will take effort, and will take real political will to address some of these challenges.
Yeah, a quick comment, not directly related to necessarily to air conditioning, but You know, one of the things that's been really remarkable in, again, in Kazakhstan is that there's the growth, I mean, part of this 5% figure that we heard of wind energy with very, you know, sort of maybe unlikely partners. The EBRD has been involved in that. Chinese have been involved in sort of massively growing the capacity of wind energy in Kazakhstan. So I think there are places where there are unlikely solutions necessarily that are partners that we wouldn't necessarily, you know, be the ones that we would think rationally or logically are going to be the partners that come together. And I would also, again, just looking at sort of smaller community-based initiatives. We did a series of interviews last year at Crude Accountability with climate activists from around Eurasia and actually from around the OSCE region. And one of the activists who we spoke with was working in mountain communities in Tajikistan, where they were trying to address energy issues at the village level, right? So that small communities could figure out what was the best energy, appropriate energy solution for their community. And it might not be the same one as it was for the next village over, but empowering people on the one hand to make decisions, but also holding people responsible for what is actually happening in their communities and giving them the tools to engage then with local administrations and local governments, not necessarily at the national level, but in the regional level. So I think there's a whole variety of responses and a whole variety of solutions that we have to take advantage of as we address the issue.
All right, thank you very much. So we've come to the end of our time, and the next panel will start in 15 minutes. So please join me in thanking our panelists for a group of excellent presentations.